Welcome to Alaska Edition, a weekly public affairs program produced by Alaska Public Media in the studios of KAKM.
Hello, and welcome to Alaska Edition on Alaska Public Media. I'm your host, Ellen Locke, here. With the current budget bottleneck in the state legislature, there is both good and bad news for communities. Some bills that would have increased costs for local governments are on the shelf this session, while there is certainty that the communities statewide will be receiving less revenue sharing. While lawmakers struggle to close the budget gap, most headlines are focused on the big picture. But what about the small screen? Today, we'll take a look at how the state's fiscal crisis is translating in small-town Alaska. First, let's introduce our guests. Dacia Eaton is news director at KBBI-FM Public Radio in Homer. Hello, Dacia. Joe Vigil is an anchor and a reporter with the Anchorage television station KTVA. Hello, Joe.
Good afternoon.
And Nathan Hill is a manager with the Lake and Peninsula Borough. Hello, Nathan.
Hi, thanks.
Thanks for joining us. Let's get to it with the legislature now holed up in the fifth day of their extended session. Nothing much is moving. I'm getting a lot of talk about, well, maybe they're going to pass a crime bill, then they're going to go to recess for a week. If that's the proper term, they're going to come back in session at the LIO in Anchorage, and that is the building they have just agreed to purchase, whereas the Governor Walker has vowed to veto that purchase, and that about wraps up where the legislature and the governor stand. So far, we do not have a comprehensive fiscal plan, as Walker has asked for, which would include restructuring of the permanent fund, broad-based taxes, and cuts, but that is still pending, and probably nothing will move on that before another week or so. So the big picture is getting a lot of press attention. Are they going to raid the CBR, the Constitutional Budget Reserve? Are they going to restructure the oil and gas taxes for small companies in Cook Inlet, and that's still all pending. So let's start with Dacia Eaton. Dacia, what are you hearing around Homer? You're right on there on Cook Inlet, so.
We are on Cook Inlet. Well, Homer, as many people may know, is full of nonprofits. It also has a small city government, and people are nervous. People are worried about what's going to happen. I guess the not knowing is almost worse, not hearing more detailed plans about what's going to happen moving forward. The city is very nervous about a number of things. They've already ruled out revenue sharing. They're not even counting that in their budget. So they're kind of ahead of the game there. But they have lots of other concerns, like they lost their community jail funding already, and their jail is kind of a safety concern. It's been flooding regularly, and so they don't have money for that. And then on top of it, they've already eliminated 6.5 positions from the city through attrition, and they feel that if they have more losses, if there are more cuts coming down from the legislature, they may actually have to lay people off. And they're a pretty big employer. They employ around 100 people there.
Well, but is there a little bit of a bright spot? I think that DOT is releasing some money for local road projects.
DOT, yeah. Well, there it seems as though DOT. I don't know if you guys have noticed this where you are, but it seems as though they are trying to get as many roads projects as they can get done. And so they've already started. I just received a press release this week that they had started up in the Soldotna Kenai area, and we should expect a lot of road work this summer. I guess they figure, well, get it done now before the money runs out. That might put a few people to work, I guess.
Well, hopefully that every little bit helps. And one more thing about Homer is you said they are completely zeroing out any revenue sharing.
They're just planning not to get it.
So what about the nonprofits you mentioned? Is there sort of a struggle now between among them?
Transportation nonprofits. DOT gave out half the number of grants to nonprofits that help do transportation on the Kenai Peninsula this year that they usually do. And as a result, there's been kind of fighting, honestly, between local nonprofits over money already. You know, they don't have a Kenai Peninsula-wide bus system there. Instead, they have a van system, and you have to call 24 hours in advance, and you have to wait 15 minutes before, and 15 minutes. It's a big process. That agency, CARTS, it's called, got all the money, about $700,000 worth of grant money, and nobody else got anything. Usually a place called Independent Living Center gets that, and they provide taxi vouchers that are subsidized by the state for people with disabilities and elderly folks who live out in those rural areas, so they can go to church, so they can get their hair done, so that they can go to the grocery store. And as of now, they will not have that service anymore.
Right, so that's a very telling, small but very compelling thing. Elderly people won't be able to get rides. Nathan Hill, let's talk a little bit about Lake and Peninsula Borough. Tell us a little bit about your area.
Lake and Peninsula Borough is comprised of 16 villages. Some are incorporated, some are unincorporated. We've got six cities within the Lake and Pen Borough. The majority of our revenue is generated with fish taxes. We do get some revenue from hunters, guides, tourism. And we have a low population but a large expanse of land. We're about 400 miles between Lake Clark area and the Chignecks or Ivanoff Bay down in the Alaska Peninsula. So it's maybe apples and oranges to some of the other municipalities and boroughs, but we, you know, we've got a population of under 2,000 people in a land mass about the size of West Virginia. So it is a little different than, I guess, the other, probably some of the other municipalities. So I guess that's the Lake and Pen Borough in a nutshell. We focus a lot of our expenditures and a lot of our energy into education, energy and transportation. Not necessarily in that order, but we try to bring the cost of living down and help build capacity within the communities. Alternative energy projects has been a major focus lately. Mm-hmm. And transportation, we also are focusing on waterfront for delivering of goods to the communities in the southern part of our borough.
So you'd say you're fishing, the fishing industry and fishing support businesses are the backbone of your economy?
Yeah, okay. They are.
And what are you anticipating with cuts in revenue sharing? How does the borough distribute it? Does the borough get it and then distribute it to the smaller communities?
The borough gets revenue sharing. The municipalities within the borough, they get the revenue sharing directly from the state. And then with the unincorporated communities, we receive the funding, and by mandate from the state, we deliver some of the revenue sharing to them.
So everyone's going to feel the pain.
And
you mentioned fish taxes earlier. Mm-hmm. Wasn't there a bill that would rework the fish taxes so that the state would get some of it or all of it?
Yeah, I think the bill was to increase the fish tax. I want to say it was 1%. And from what I've gathered and what I've heard, that would just go directly to the state, and I don't believe that the borough would see any of the additional revenue stay in the borough.
Okay, so the state would take sort of up the tax
a little
bit and then skim off
the
top. Okay, I don't know where that bill is either. So Joe V. Hill, let's talk a little bit about Anchorage.
Right.
I know right now the port is the big thing. But it does affect virtually everybody in the state.
Sure does.
Tell us what's happening with the port.
Okay, well, they're wanting $290 million, basically, from the legislature to do phase two. And this would basically be a modernization of the port. And yet, you have to keep in mind that 85% of the goods that come in to Alaska come in right through the port. So they're saying this is a must-have. We needed to get bigger ships in there to modernize, to deal with possible earthquake issues. And they're saying if we don't get it, we don't need it right now, we don't need the whole chunk right now, but if we don't get it over 10 years, then you're going to have to start reducing capacity, reducing loads, and they say that will be a disaster for Alaska, Anchorage, because of all the goods that come in. So what do you do there? Do you, if you don't get it there, do you move a port to Whittier? Do you go to Seward? Do you have to start building infrastructure? What about the roads? So that's what the port is saying. $290 million, it's a lot of money. Some legislators probably see the importance, I think, of the port. There may be some that see it as a lot of money and you're not gonna get it right away. But the port is basically saying if we don't get it all right away, we can do, you know, pay as we go. But what they want is a guarantee that they'll get that money so they know that they can move forward. But again, $290 million.
And this would be, the Muni wants a general obligation bond put on the state ticket in November, but the legislature would have to approve that, right? So where we are there, what's the likelihood of the legislature saying, yeah, $290 million?
Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, the hope is that they're going to, again, can we get it at least pay as we go? I think I don't think anybody thinks they're going to write them a check for $290 million and there you go, build everything. Mm-hmm. But it's a tough situation. I mean, because I've talked to smaller communities and there's sewer and water everywhere that have to be done. They can't get done. And so everybody wants, of course, a piece of the pie. So where's it all going to come from? I mean, $4 billion, it's a hard figure to think about. I mean, 999 million times four, it's just, kind of boggles the mind. And so, where are we going to get it?
Where are we going to get it? Then there's, those are the big issues. Smaller issues would be the Anchorage election in just this earlier this month. The I think it was a $50 million school bond package.
Mm-hmm.
Did not pass.
Did not pass.
And that was a big eye opener for a lot of people. Do you have reasons that it didn't pass?
Well, the school board sure wants to know what happened. Mm-hmm. They're actually going to do some research, call some voters and say, why not? What happened there? Speculation, maybe it was too much, $50 million maybe too much. Maybe that we're not getting funds reimbursed from the state for five more years. Or, as Daisha talked about, uncertainty. That's a word I've heard a lot lately, is uncertainty. How can you plan if there is no plan? And so people sit and wait, and just wait, and they don't really know what to do. Like, for instance, with revenue sharing, of course, here in Anchorage, we know we're going to take a hit. We are fortunate to have a $14 million surplus right now. That came from fuel savings. It came from cost savings within departments. And so we have this $14 million buffer. So if we get hit $4 million, $5 million, well, the mayor is going to save some of that, hold some of that money back in case we do take a big hit. So again, not a lot of communities can do that, mm-hmm. but we're fortunate in that respect that there's a little extra to buffer any revenue sharing cuts.
Right, and then other issues, public safety, the Prop 9 recount passed now, I think by three votes, but the Prop 9 question on the Anchorage municipal ticket was who's gonna fund Girdwood law enforcement now that budget cuts are cutting the trooper posts there. So this particular issue is virtually everywhere. Do you have any comments on Prop 9?
Well, now we go to Whittier Police and try to work something out with them,
right,
and say, well, and if you have a $300,000 house property out there in Girdwood, it's going to cost you about $350 a year extra to do this. But then again, you think about your permanent funds, how much are you going to get from that? That could possibly be a cut. I mean, cut. Everywhere you go, there's kind of a cut. So, but they seem like they've got that figured out, though, as far as police protection. They've said, yes, we're going to do it. It's very close. Every vote account in that one. So now they move ahead with trying to figure that out. But mm-hmm. That's a direct impact from the troopers' budgets being slashed.
Right. Well, Daisha, one of the big sticking points in the legislature right now is the change to the oil and gas tax structure for small producers in Cook Inlet. That's your area. Mm-hmm. What are you hearing? How will a change strike home locally?
Well, right outside Homer, we have Blue Crest Energy, and they're in Anchor Point, and they actually just got their first oil out of the ground, I believe, on March 30th, and that was an existing well. They just started pumping it out, but they're getting, I think it's 250 to 300 gallons a day, and they trucked their first load out this week. We also have Fury. I think it's Fury Operating Alaska, something like that, and they're out there too. What we're hearing from officials with those companies, particularly Blue Crest, is that if they don't take care of this oil and tax thing pretty soon, it's making them nervous. And if those tax credits go away, they don't know if they'll keep going. So again, uncertainty. The companies have uncertainty, and it certainly seems like they're trying to move as fast as they can to get that oil out of the ground and get things moving so they can show what they're doing.
Right.
So it's kind of having an unintended consequence possibly there.
Right. The change could nip in the bud the forward progress
right.
of these companies.
They're just getting going. And actually, both companies just applied this week for additional permits. So ramping up here.
Right. So and local jobs, are there local jobs depending upon
these companies? There are some local jobs. Yeah. In fact, Blue Crest in particular has worked with a local college mm-hmm. there, KPC, and they have a training program, and they are hiring right out of that program to work for Blue Crest.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's not a ton of jobs, but there are some valuable local jobs.
Right, and even in those small communities, and I've lived in several of them, one or two jobs is felt at the grocery store, at the restaurants, at the electric light company. So it looks like less state money means coming into communities means higher costs for local entities. That translates to like higher fees at the dump, higher fees at the swimming pool. Nathan, what is your borough looking at in
well,
that respect?
Well, we don't tax land, we don't tax property. Okay. We are trying to, of course, keep the cost of living down as low as possible. And if we start taxing locals that maybe don't have an income or don't have an industry, then it doesn't really make sense for us. So we've been kicking around a few ideas. Our fish taxes, we haven't looked at raising that. Luckily enough, we've got some reserves, and we're working on an interim, long-term plan right now. Education is taking a good extra chunk of our general fund right now, and we're trying to figure out how to fill the gap. We do have taxes that flow into the our revenue stream from tourism, the hunting, the guiding, the bed tax. We haven't raised any taxes yet. We're taking a good hard look at things, and I think probably if the first thing that we're going to consider would be to raise possibly bed tax, guide tax to help to buffer the current deficit. And we've also been pretty proactive on making cuts in our own administration, in our own school district, to the point where we've cut 20% of our staff, which means only one person. But that was a planner position. The rest of the staff is soaking that up, and we're tightening the belt. And luckily enough, we've got substantial savings that allow us time to think this through and make sound decisions about how we're going to make ends meet and have a sustainable budget in the future.
So hunting and fishing lodges and guides could be paying a little more in taxes.
Well, we've got two national parks. There's the Lake Clark National mm-hmm. Park and the Katmai National Park right. that are within the boundaries of our borough. And so there's a lot of traffic that comes through. Tens of thousands of people visit the Lake and Pen Borough every year.
Right.
And so there is potential there for us. And we do generate it's a fair percentage of our revenue from that right now. It's in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, not the millions of dollars. Mm. But it's a good chunk of our revenue, and I think that'll end up being one of our answers to one of our solutions to this.
Right. Well, another bill that's uncertain, maybe will be stuck in the legislature, maybe will never pass. Would take money from the Power Cost Equalization Fund and to pay for state programs. So this is like a $900 million fund, but now if the legislature were to take some of that money, how would your residents feel the pinch?
I think across the borough, I think there's 16 out of the 17 communities have power in them. The 16 communities would definitely feel the pinch. I think if I tallied the numbers recently, that was around $1 million goes into this subsidization of PCE. And most of our utilities are standalone utilities. The cost of producing that kilowatt hour is high. The power cost equalization put in the numbers. There's communities that are paying upwards to $1 a kilowatt hour. It brings that rate down to, a more manageable 40 cents a kilowatt hour For the first 500 kilowatt hours of every month, that would be a pretty big number to pull out of the back pocket of the local people.
Right. I'm astonished sometimes when you hear about the electric bills in the rural areas for a small cabin with maybe two lights and a stove, you know.
Yeah.
It's mind-boggling. So one of the big headlines is restructuring of the permanent fund and a possible reduction of the PFD dividend check, which affects literally every infant, mm-hmm. every man, woman, and child. So let's just go around the table. Daisha, in Homer, what is a typical expense that, how do people spend their PFD checks in Homer?
Homer's interesting because there are a lot of retired and fairly well-off people there, mm-hmm. but there are also a lot of local people who aren't as well-off, and that work very hard for their money. And a lot of the work is seasonal, you know, fishing, tourism. So people do count on that PFD to get them through the winter, kind of like off the road system, mm-hmm. even though they're kind of at the end of the road. And that supplements their income for the winter. Right. So it's not unlike some of the bush communities in
right.
that way.
And Homer is on the road system, but still it's only recently become a more urbanized area, because I remember mm-hmm. when I got here, it was that little town at the end of the road and hardly anyone was there. Nathan, I'm hearing more and more so that people in rural areas rely more heavily on the permanent fund dividend check than do, say, some urban people. Is that true in your area? Would it create a hardship to not get that check?
I'd agree with you. Yeah. I think a lot of the rural villages, the rural communities, the employment opportunities and the industry isn't there. And so the percentage of income, if you're looking at the dividend check for a family of five, or that's that $2,000, it's a pretty good chunk of change. I think it is a larger part of the rural income in the households, and so it means a trip to Anchorage for the year to buy groceries. It may mean a new four-wheeler or a piece of equipment that's necessary to survive out there. So I don't know if it's entirely different, but maybe a little different proportions as far as the mm-hmm. the level of income and the amount that it helps to mm-hmm. subsidize or to, I guess, pay for things out there.
Yeah, and Joe Vigil, Anchorage, of course, has such a widespread population. There's any number of reasons to keep the permanent fund and not keep the permanent fund. But let's look at UAA cuts. How would that affect the city? I mean, that's again statewide. However, mm-hmm. we have a pretty strong institution here with the University of Alaska Anchorage, and $50 million, or is that the cut?
55 to
yeah.
70 plus.
That's going to take some
dollars.
Jobs. Yeah,
that's a lot. Well, tuition.
Right.
I mean, okay,
yeah.
10 to 15%.
Right.
I think we've heard the figures
mm-hmm.
of a tuition increase. 33%, I believe we just talked about this the other night, a 33% possible cut to UAA athletics. So imagine taking 33% of your salary and cutting it tomorrow and trying to figure things out. How would that work for you? And that's kind of what they're looking at. The Great American Shootout, the basketball tournament, could that be around? I mean, that's one of the things that they're concerned about. So a lot of things are on the table. And again, I keep hearing it, but the uncertainty is driving people nuts, I think, in some cases, because they just can't plan. What do we do? Mm-hmm. So they're just waiting. But that's a huge amount of money. I mean, the programs you're talking about in the UA system, 60, 70 programs, how many hundreds of layoffs are you talking about? I've also heard this recently. Somebody from a large company told me that he's quite confident we're going to go into a recession. How bad is it going to be? He says depends on what the legislature does. So it's kind of scary. I mean, I don't know if we've heard the R word too much, but There it is.
The R word.
Well, throw it out there.
It's out there. The governor just announced this morning, though, a little bit of a bright spot that the state has. He's just approved a measure to sell state royalty oil to Tesoro, and it looks like that's going to bring in $50 million or more to the state coffers, and that was just this morning. But on the other side, there is like state, there's another bill out there pending that would not allow state employees to receive pay hikes based on experience without, anyway, it's a long complicated formula. And there's others, like I know in the Mat-Su borough, they are not going to get the money they need to finish the railroad spur, which would enable Port McKenzie to grow and become an economic center. And this is amazing how fast it's gone, but we are out of time here on Alaska Edition. I'd like to thank my guests, Stacia Eaton, Joe Vigil, Nathan Hill. Thanks for tuning in. We've had a great half hour discussion. I'm your host, Ellen Lockyer. We'll be back next week. Thanks for tuning in.
If you have questions or comments about the program, you can email Alaska Edition at alaskapublic.org or write us at 3877 University Drive, Anchorage, Alaska, 99508. Alaska Edition is a production of KAKM. The opinions expressed are those of the hosts and guests and do not necessarily represent those of KSKA, KAKM, the licensee, or their underwriters.